So Australians have high levels of trust in their electoral processes. They conceive them as immune from most corruption problems. They have faith in the mechanics of their electoral process. So if people have faith that they're not just going through the motions, that it's a corrupt process, they're much happier with being compelled to vote. So the take-home message there is make sure elections are conducted scrupulously, professionally, with no actual and perceived corruption. I know it seems like an obvious point. Oh, why don't you do this? Of course we should all do this. But it's just extremely important if you're going to require people to vote. The good news there is that if your electoral system isn't up to scratch now, judging by Australian experience, once you adopt compulsory voting, it may soon be, because we believe that the introduction of compulsory voting is what drove the high standards of electoral integrity and management in our country. Once the state had decided everyone had to vote, it started funding and the electoral commissions and setting them up and resourcing them and introducing all these very stringent standards. And so if you're a bit dodgy to start with, you might perk up a bit after you've had compulsory voting for a while. That high standard of service, in turn, has reinforced the idea that compulsory voting is a legitimate violation, violation of your autonomy. And it is a violation of your autonomy, but it all depends on whether you consider it legitimate. Six, I suppose my final point is this. If you're going to compel people to vote, try and do as much as you can to make voting a meaningful process for people. Compulsory voting has to have a payoff. Make sure it's not just getting people to go through the democratic motions. And you want to protect against that idea that compulsion is a violation of democratic choice. So try and expand choice in other direction. It is a violation of democratic choice, the choice not to vote, but if you can offer choice in other directions, people will accept it. There are a number of strategies available to meet the objection that it does that. Sarah has also already mentioned my idea of conscientious objectors, and I believe the criteria for that should be quite tough. And it would need to be shown that a conflicting and more compelling duty than the duty to vote is at stake, and you would need to get permission beforehand. The sort of person that should get that is Mr. Judd, who is the classic case for right not to vote in Australia. He was a communist who said he shouldn't have to vote because his party forbade him from voting because all the other parties were implicated in the perpetuation of capitalism. But the court said, no, you have to vote. But I sort of thought, poor Mr. Judd, he should be allowed not to vote. He means business. He's politically active. Apathy is not his problem. And after all, apathy is the problem we're trying to address. Let that one go. You can see why courts don't want to open the door. I understand completely. The second idea is to provide ballot papers that capture a much wider repertoire of political responses. So I'm advocating having a little section there that people can write their protests on. Informal voters or formal voters could use that. You know, even if you want to vote formally, you might want to put in a bit of a protest. I know I would. We could do that. That would expand choice. Offering positive abstention, which Sarah has already mentioned, offers choice as well. We know that's been done in a number of settings and with no controversy whatsoever. Now, this might give the impression that I'm advocating turning up to vote just so it can be said that people have gone through the motions. You get them to go and then just write none of the above. And people have said that to me in papers writing against my work. What's the point of that? They're saying that compelling reluctant citizens to vote seems like a waste of theirs and everyone else's time if it means they'll only spoil their ballots or record positive abstention. I think that when that latter option is available, it offers the disaffected an opportunity for democratic expression that is far superior to staying at home. It conveys some vitally important democratic information to politicians, potential politicians and potential new parties and other voters. It communicates to other voters, look, I don't like it. Do you not like it? No, we didn't like it either. There's a whole bunch, we're all together here, we all didn't like it. People that are thinking of becoming a politician, oh, there's all these people there that think there should be another electoral option here. Maybe there should be a new party. And existing politicians within existing parties might get the message that people don't like what you're doing. Maybe we need to change this. In any case, as I've already mentioned, once you do get people to turn up to vote, they do vote formally, and usually in their own self-interest. Now, a lot of people who don't like compulsory voting are saying, oh, why are we getting all these idiots to vote? They really think non-voters are idiots. And the reason why most people don't vote is that they have dominant language competency problems, they're isolated, they're new migrants, they have numeracy and literacy problems, They're poor, they're homeless, they have all these disadvantages that incite sort of what I call political shyness. But when you do get these people to vote, it turns out they vote in their own interests, absolutely. If that weren't the case, why would we see more income distribution in high turnout elections? They know exactly what to do. As far as positive abstention goes, in places like Australia and the Netherlands before 1970, when it dropped compulsory voting, the attitude of the state is that if a person decides to spoilerly blank her ballot once inside the polling booth, that's her business. The most the state can do is provide a quality of access to opportunity, to political opportunity, saying, we can't tell you to mark the ballot or who to vote for, but we want you to have this opportunity to participate in self-government and self-protection. And I think that compulsion is analogous to the state requirement of everyone that everyone should receive a basic education. Although not everyone that goes to school wants to learn, nevertheless the state wants you to have that opportunity. Have a go. You might have parents that don't think you need to go to school or are not able in one way or another to get you to go through their own disadvantage or problems. The state says, look, let's get you there and see what happens. If you don't want to learn, there's not a lot I can do, but maybe you would like to learn, but I'm going to make sure you've got that opportunity. Just as being uneducated vastly limits a person's choices and her capacity for human flourishing, so does voting abstention only permit a person to communicate a silence that is unambiguous in every way except one. Its ability to convey one very simple message, feel free to ignore me. And that's exactly what states do when you don't vote. People sort of say, I've seen papers that say, oh, silence is very eloquent. It's not really. It's very hard to interpret silence. The only message it gives you is the message, ignore me. Attendance at a booth gives voters a greater range of options than abstention. Among them, a formal vote, a protest vote, a punishment vote, a reward vote, a scribbled on ballot, and even in some cases, positive abstention. Even blank votes communicate something. Believe it or not, we can look at conditions on the ground and see what caused that spike in blank ballots. But most people who do vote end up using their vote to protect their own interests and to participate in self-protection. So the take-home message for Britain would be offer options that enable protest voting or none of the above options, such as positive abstention, and make sure that informal voting is legal. Or even do what our electoral commissions do here, which is something I just love to bits. They now get all the informal votes, they count them all, they divide them all, they categorise them all. So they separate the intentional and the unintentionals. Then among the intentionals, they take out the blanks, and then they take out the scribbled on, then they take out the scribbled on, and they work out what they record, what people wrote on the scribbled on ballots. How many complained about compulsory voting? Hardly anyone, 0.014%, which I find very interesting information. How many wrote profanity? How many wrote, I'm an anarchist, I can't stand this? This is very interesting information to me and to lots of people. Which brings me to my next point, which is about informal voting, which is probably the biggest elephant in the room for compulsory voting in the UK. Watch out for a rise in informal voting. That is going to happen. It is completely natural, and it's not even necessarily a bad thing. And don't freak out about it. And don't listen to people who say that's a reason not to have compulsory voting. That is not a good enough reason. But we know that compulsory voting regimes have higher than average levels of informal voting. We have high levels of unintentional informal voting and high levels of intentional informal voting. The unintentional informal voting is quite benign. It's sad, but it's still benign. It just means, look, people with English language deficiencies and people with numeracy and literacy problems, they're having trouble. People have never voted before. They're not quite sure how to do it. I've been enfranchised. That's a good thing. Learning how to vote is something that takes time. And these problems can be addressed through education programs. So it's no reason to exclude the poor. It's something to be sort of glad about in a weird way. And you also want to try and minimise intentional informal voting. Again, that's something that can be ameliorated. Now, Britain is more vulnerable to this problem than Australia, this problem of informal voting, because it uses a first-past-the-post system. And we already know that because of the choice restricting effect of that form of voting, a lot of people just abstain as kind of almost a form of protest or kind of giving up because they've got no chance of getting representation. You live in a safe seat, you know your candidate isn't going to win, you don't even bother to go, there's no preference voting, there's no proportionality, so they don't vote. What people will do in a first-past-the-post system under a compulsory voting regime, because it's not a good combination, is informal vote. The other problem you're going to get, the other reason it's going to be a problem is that most of this legislation would be directed at, this legislation would be mostly directed at young people, but there'll be other kinds of people that would be directed at, but it'll mostly affect young people. And I think that young people are more prone to vote informally than the rest of the population. So in about 2011, I started to get suspicious that I thought the spikes in informal voting were driven by young people. And then I thought I would like to test that. Then in last summer, Sarah Rutledge Pry, who's just sitting there, is my summer research scholar, came to me and said, oh, I'd like to do a project with you. And I said, well, I want to try and find out if young people are doing the majority of the informal voting here in this country, or if you're more likely to vote informally if you're young. So Sarah, who's a maths whiz, as well as a social science and theory whiz, helped me out with that. And by when I say helped me out with it, I mean crunched all the numbers and did an absolutely fantastic job. And we tested for it, and sure enough, here's what we found using the Australian election study, that if you're young, and by that we meant here, under the age of 45, which to me is young, but not to Sarah, you're twice as likely to vote informally. Just seems to happen at the age of 45, suddenly you're more likely, twice as likely. And there's that figure, those figures expressed another way. And then we also tested for that. When I say we, I said to Sarah, could you go and, and she did, go and find out, look at the aggregate level data, because a good social scientist will always check survey data against the aggregate level data. And Sarah laboriously got all the census data and the AEC data as well for voting patterns. And she found that at the aggregate level, the in any area where young people were concentrated, the informal vote rate was higher. So that is going to be something, I think, for people in Britain to watch out for. So to conclude, or to conclude that point anyway, and I'll just conclude that point and finish the whole paper. Parties in the UK will need to be more responsive to the priorities of the young, as you've quite rightly emphasised, Sarah. We should have ballots that permit protest and positive abstention, because informal voting is the only legal exit option in compulsory voting settings. You need to provide kind of like a safety valve for people to express themselves and to exit. And also, you know, obviously move to a proportional or even preferential system, but obviously that's easy for me to say, isn't it? Because I've already tried to move to a preferential system and it didn't succeed. But just remember that the rise in informal voting is not necessarily terrible. It can be a sign of something positive happening. And I think I won't read my conclusion out. I think I'll stop there because I'm exhausting people with all this detail. Thanks.